Your bluntness is amazing. I have a service dog in public access. He never hears that very often.
What? How dare you say that?
I have a service dog and public access is impossible without punishment. Tasks are impossible without rewards. Thanks for your honesty and openness. Would you look at that?
You're welcome. Yeah, the whole service dog, the service dog community needs to they need to wake up. They need to wake up, especially the folks that are self-training. With nothing against self-training, but it's like, if you really have a service dog, if you truly have a service dog, that dog better know what a punisher is, because it needs to perform. It is performing a job to an incredibly high level of success, or else you have to wash the dog out. So, and the way you get that is through proper application of a punisher, aversive control. It's the way it is. Of course you use rewards to train the stuff. Well, now it's time to put into the real world. Next.
Go figure.
Hey, everybody. How are you? It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. This is, what night are we on? Wednesday night. Joelle is sitting next to me. Hey, everybody on Spotify, SoundCloud, on iHeartRadio, and on all the Google platforms. We got the right camera on. And we do a Q&A show. This tonight's show is 90 minutes long. You ask questions, we give you answers. Right down at the bottom where it says say something, you're putting your questions in. Right below that is a top chat button. You can do that. A lot of people like to throw a little bit of cash our way. But all questions get answered that we have time for. So a 90-minute show, we try to get through all of the questions. Most of these folks, you guys need a board and train to answer them, or you need a Skype session to answer them. But we do our best in the 15 to 30 seconds per question that I dedicate to it. If you're not familiar with the work we do some serious rehab work. We do a lot of aggression rehab, leash reactivity, major leash reactivity, separation anxiety, name every bad behavior that a dog can have. And we do that, human and dog aggression. But we also deal with, young puppies, like little puppies. We actually have three classes starting up. We're doing a nose work class, a puppy class, a puppy socialization class, trick training class, four new classes. And then our pack walks are starting up again. So we got five things happening starting in the first week of June. Obviously, we do a big board and train business, and we do one-on-one. I personally tour the world. I'm doing dog training seminars.
Who's that?
Where?
Did I just hear the door?
It could be Angelo. It's his bedtime. I tour the world doing dog training seminars, 25 dates this year, all in North America. 2020, we'll be doing some more international ones. You can go to jeffgellmanseminars.com, jeffgellmanseminars.com for that information. And then some folks do need a Skype. So if you've got a really complicated question or if you need extra help, we do about, 7 hours, I think, a week of free Q&A. But some people need more than that. They need a one-on-one coaching, which is what I do. I mean, that's what I do for a living. So you can always do a Skype, and all that information's up on our website. I talk a lot about punishments. The reason why I talk so much about punishments, because most questions, if not all of the questions tonight, are people that ask how to stop something. And then when I do my seminar tour, it's a 2-day seminar. Everybody is there to learn how to stop stuff, They're not learning how to do basic obedience. They're learning on how to stop unwanted behaviors, how to stop dangerous behaviors. Believe it or not, we all have 20 dogs there, all leash reactive. Some of them are aggressive, all in a room next to each other in quiet. The photos are incredible, all within a day or two. Pretty incredible stuff we do. All right. So you can hear me talk a lot about punishment. The reason why I talk about punishment is because the only way to stop an unwanted behavior is through the proper application of aversive control or a punisher. You cannot reward your dog away from an unwanted behavior. It cannot be done. You're being lied to. So I talk about that a lot. We also, by the way, when we want to train a dog to do something, we use food and clickers. So we're food trainers. So we do that, just like a lot of people do. That's great for teaching commands, great for teaching tasks, great for teaching tricks, great for teaching a lot of agility, wanted things. But to stop stuff, food don't work. So here we go. Next.
Dog Civ guy. Hi guys. Thanks so much for doing this show. I've been doing your come sit break drills on my guy, but I can't get him to listen when I don't have food. When should I start seeing results? Thanks.
Well, if we do come sit break on puppies. So come sit break is on puppies and you do hundreds, if not thousands of repetitions up until like 14 weeks old. And then you start doing more leash work. So, I mean, for an adult dog, we would stop doing that and we would do like, you know, leash and prong and do a little bit more leash pressure. But for a puppy, if you're consistent with your puppy every mealtime and then a couple of times during the day of doing it, you should start seeing it. But I don't know how old your dog is. Next.
Jamie, for someone that has a 50-hour work week, how would you recommend they get started into your style of dog training? This has been a passion of mine and I'm sick of letting it get away. Any advice?
So Jamie, do you mean you want to start training dogs for a living? Well, you have 50 hours a week. You have 118 hours a week that you're not working. What are you doing with that time? How much TV are you watching? Video games, going out. Like, what are you doing? How many hours of that do you need to sleep? Let's say, I mean, me, I sleep 4 to 5 hours, but say you need 8 hours. That's 40 hours. That's 56 hours. You still got a good 40 hours a week to dedicate to dog training. So what do? Intern somewhere, work for free, work tons of dogs, immerse yourself into it. Next.
Mary, suggested resources for raw food recipes for dogs, please. Looking forward to meeting you and your team and learning lots in Elkhart.
Go to karmavore, karma, K-A-R-M-A, vore.com. They'll help you out. Next.
Top chat
for $4.99. Thank you. Matthew. Hey, Matthew. Dog is fearful of new men that come into our home and barks incessantly and ignores commands. Is knee collar correction the best way to correct this? Okay. So, Matthew, great question. A punisher will stop it. So, a couple of things I want you to think about, Matthew. Don't use a command to stop an unwanted behavior. Don't use a command to stop an unwanted behavior. So, the dog is barking and you're telling it to what? Sit, down, place, come over here, leave it. Like, don't do that. Now, you want to be able to say no and then apply a punisher. So a remote collar is going to help. A bark collar automatically helps. A bonker also works. So a leash pop will work as well. This is a great time for me to bring up for all the people out there that have been brainwashed that by doing that, the dog will have a negative association with the male guest and then do what? Bark more? Start to bite? Nope. We punish dogs all the time for unwanted behaviors. I tour the world doing it. We've got a big social media presence. People do it as well. And I'm not getting all these people saying, oh my gosh, my dog got worse. Could it get worse? Yes, it could. But that means you did it wrong. And then we'll tweak it. And then it technically wasn't a punisher. But David came to me already with a problem. The dog already has a perception of that human. It has nothing to do with me. I've never met David. Actually, David is, I think, a new listener on the show because I've never seen his name before. So we've never met. So nothing I did made that dog bark at men. People forget the timeline. People don't listen to the narrative. A lot of folks will be like, well, I'm like, whoa, 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 whoa. No. Like, the problem exists already. So always remember that when you start hearing about this imagined harm or supposed like negative association, you're going to hear these catchphrases. I want everyone to start thinking about it and going, you know what? The problem's already there. Like, no. This didn't start it and it stops it. Next.
Melissa says, hello, Jeff.
Hey, Melissa, how are you?
Feisty pet training and boarding. Hello, hello. Happy to be here this evening.
Happy you're here too.
Kimberly, my five-month-old pup is getting confused between the sit and down commands. How can I help her understand?
I'm easy. Teacher, trainer, Reinforce sit, reinforce down. Tell the dog to sit. If it downs, say at this stage of the game, wrong, put it into a sit. So that's what you do. So sit, your marker word, good or yes, reward. Do sit drills, do down drills. Next.
Michelle, good evening. Jeff and Joelle, amazed that you're still awake after pulling an all-nighter with a new dog, Joelle. Kudos for your dedication and thank you.
Yes. This is the thing. You were up. She was up all night long. She doesn't sleep as it is, but last night was a special night with this new dog. We did a, if anybody didn't see our Facebook Live, we did a Facebook Live today. I gave a little synopsis into the world of us, what we do, and then a special case that we've got in right now. Next.
Kristen, my heel tap is becoming natural. Thank you.
Kristen, that I love. It's like dancing. Next.
I'm not going to pronounce this. Yep. I've been wondering what good ways to burn energy to a hyper energetic dog can you recommend? Thanks to you. Her training is great. I heard scent work was good. Can you advocate?
So this is the thing. Yeah, scent work is great, but this is the thing. I've got three high drive working line dogs right next to me. One Malinois, two German Shepherds. They spend, 20 hours a day. 20 hours a day doing nothing. Yeah. I control their energy. Right now, if I wanted to run them for 20 miles, they'd go. Right now, if I wanted to swim them for 2 hours, they'd go. They'd walk through the night right now. Absolutely, they would walk through the night. But guess what? I'm doing a podcast. Go lie down and do nothing. After this, I'm going to do some office work. They'll still be lying down after this. And it's not like we ran that much today. I actually missed one of my exercise sessions today with my dogs because it was a crazy day. So it's not like they're exhausted. So work on duration work. Now, I'm not saying don't find things for your dog to do, but a lot of people, what they're doing is this. They're finding too many things for the dog to do. The dog never learns how to do nothing. And then they run into trouble. Master the art of doing nothing, especially when the dog is not tired. Next.
Julie, hi guys. I'm from Argentina and I'm right. I don't know.
Yep.
Something to feed my 4-month-old doggo Argentino. Yep. She gets really aggressive every time I try to feed her. I don't know what to do. I really need help.
Okay. So 4-month-old dog, for a lot of dogos are coming out aggressive, by the way, right now. So we're seeing that a lot. But As far as aggressive around the food, aggressive from your hand, aggressive from the food bowl. So I don't know the details, but let's say, for example, you're feeding your dog. First of all, at 16 weeks old, we do all food training. So we're feeding the dog with the commands. Sit, mark it with yes or good, reward. Down, mark it with yes or good, reward. Recall, and then do that thousands of times. So it's not feeding the dog from our hand. It's like food training, and that's what you do. Like the food comes from your hand. So what I want you to do is this. Say you're feeding your dog, do that. But say you're feeding from your dog from a bowl and it gets aggressive. What I want you to do, yes, you can do this at 16 weeks old. Because if you don't do this now, the dogo at 16 weeks old, you'll own the dogo at 1 year old that when you walk into the room, Julie, your dog runs across the room and attacks you. Like it happens to my clients. That's what happens. It starts at 16 weeks old or earlier. Right? They try to redirect it. They slowly feed the dog out of the bowl by hand, which is fucking bullshit. Okay. And then they never address it. And then what happens is you've got a fully mature, I know a year old, the dog's not fully mature, but you've got a mature dogo who will attack you. Will attack you. So what do you do right now? Here's the food bowl. Oh, you're going to be aggressive? Don't say this. This is the thought process. No, you've got these in Argentina. Boom. Release it on the dog. Okay, you won't injure the dog. The latest thing about bonkers is they're causing brain injuries. Like, that's the big thing. People are asking me about that. I'm like, and they're making comments on my page. Oh, so you want to give your dog a brain injury? I'm like, where did all this come from all of a sudden? All of a sudden, it's like, Oh my gosh. First it was fear, and then it was lack of trust, and then it was ruining a relationship, and now it's brain injuries from a fucking towel. I mean, let's be honest, guys. How many of you have been playing chuck it with your dog and you go to pick up the ball with a chuck it stick and the dog all goes for it and you bop the dog on the head? I have. How many of you have seen a puppy get run over by another dog and tumble? I have. How many of you have had a dog that's ever run into something? I've had a dog run through into a tree. Kira went through a fucking windshield, not an empty one. She shattered a windshield.
With her head.
With her head. I documented it. It's like, trust me, I didn't want her to do it. Like, hey, but like that alone, that's like 1,000 bonks. So all these folks out there that now are like, they're really like pushing the line to like, don't bonk. Next, it's like, if you bonk your dog, it'll explode. No. You do it now. Next.
Miggity Marsh, listen to your talk about the extreme separation anxiety talk this morning. You mentioned that you can address normal situations in 24 hours.
Yeah.
Can you describe your normal approach?
Sure. Dog comes in for separation anxiety. It's been doing it for years. Can't be in a crate. Goes in a crate. It whines. We walk up to the crate, smack the top of the crate, smack the front of the crate, pull the dog out, bonk the dog, put the dog back in. Guess what? Not a peep. And we didn't shut the dog down. The dog is fine. Okay. What else can you do? Remote collar on the dog. Dog's being a jerk in the crate. Make it uncomfortable for the dog to be a jerk. Literally, that's how long it takes to stop 95 to 99% of separation anxiety cases. Just like that. Years and years and years of barking and whining and self-mutilation and scratching and shitting and pissing and owners being prisoners. Literally, that's how quick it stops. We do it every single day. Every day we do it. We have a track record. The cool thing about us is 7,000 dogs, mostly born and trained, we have a track record. At our seminars, we see 1,000 people a year at our seminars. 20 dogs come into a seminar, out of control. Some have never been in a crate. They're all lined up next to each other. 20 out of control dogs lined up next to each other. Guess what? Seminar starts at 9 o'clock. 9:20, not a peep. What do? I go to every single crate. I address it. Every crate. Give me your remote. Give me the bonker. Hit the top of the crate. 9:15, 9:20, they shut up. Later that night, they go home with their owners. They go to their hotel. How was your dog? Holy shit, best fucking night it's ever had. Next morning, dog comes into the seminar. Sunday morning, they go in. Not a fucking peep out of any of them. Sorry, guys. It works. Every single time, just about. Yes, there's times that it doesn't. There's always going to be a fail. All right? There's always going to be a fail. But it's enough that I can make these wide paintbrush strokes and blow this every dog has to be trained differently concept out of the water when it comes to this stuff. When it comes to applying a punisher, no. Every dog's not unique at all. And why am I all of a sudden talking so passionate, which I'm seeing where I'm screaming? Because I'm so amazed that people are fighting against this, but struggling for years. And I'm not seeing it done any other way that gets just as quick results. And quick is not bad. Quick is fantastic. How many of you get migraines? Here, take this pill. It takes 5 days for your migraine to go away. 1 day. How about this? Take this pill, 5 minutes. Your migraine will be gone and it may never reoccur. Yep, I sound cocky as fuck, don't I? But guess what? Owners are surrendering their dogs. Owners are killing their dogs. And I am standing up and I'm fighting because there's so much misinformation out there. It's such unethical fucking bullshit. And on a daily basis now, I've ramped it up. all this shit coming down on me is ramped up. Go ahead, guys. I just want you to know, when you're posting shit about me online, making videos about me online, putting shit on my page, I fucking get a hard on and I laugh. Because it doesn't bother me. If you don't like what we're doing, make a video educating the public what they should be doing. Don't worry about me. Next.
Karen, GSD lover. Good evening. Just saying hello and want to thank you for this Q&A. Nice to see your dogs in the pool again.
I know. First day of swimming for the dogs. It's still up, guys. Instagram. If you're not on our Instagram page, go to Instagram, Instagram Live. What you guys can do is check out Instagram Live. Dogs were swimming today. Next.
Mm-hmm. Kristen, and yes, the new work with the new dog is amazing.
Awesome.
Be healed dog training. Charlotte is catching a few minutes before bed. She's
Hi, Charlotte, honey. How are you? Uncle Jeff says good night. I love you, honey. Sweet dreams. Next.
I feel like I'm losing my voice. Alec, hello. I'm wanting to adopt a border collie mix from the shelter. Anything I need to look out for? How to handle the first week?
Educate yourself about border collies first. So educate yourself about a working dog, what it takes for a border collie. Figure. I usually don't go be like, well, find out what they were bred for, but find out what border collies were bred for. Yes, massive structure. The dog does not need love and affection. It needs structure. Through the structure, through the work, through the training, the relationship is built. Through the dog giving you really good stuff, the affection starts. The biggest mistake that people make is they bring these dogs home and they're affection immediate. Things are going well for a while until the dog all of a sudden gets comfortable and then goes, so I run shit here, right? Like, I run shit. Like, you old man are my bitch. That's literally what dogs are doing. So it's like, that doesn't mean to the dog. It just means structure. Yeah, take the dog for a walk. Absolutely do engagement games. Do some obedience stuff. But structure, structure, structure. Next.
Mike, Joelle, great job taking care of that dog overnight. I'm going to send you a case of coffee to keep you going if you have to do it again.
So Mike, just to let you know, make sure they're Nespresso pods or Nespresso compatible pods. That's not being a snob at all. You have an espresso machine. A Keurig pod doesn't fit.
You called me a snob for only wanting espresso.
No, I wanted to pack this. Okay, guys, we're leaving on an RV trip tomorrow, 12 days. The espresso machine I have to install in the RV. It's a new RV, so I've got to install the brackets so the espresso machine doesn't go flying all over the place. So I'm like, can you bring the espresso machine tonight when you do the podcast? No, I need it in the morning. I'm like, okay. And we have another coffee machine at work, just to let everybody know. And she drives by five of them because we live in Rhode Island, and there's Dunkin' Donuts on every corner.
You drink Dunkin'. Starbucks, you know.
So Mike, Nespresso.
Or Starbucks.
Nespresso pods compatible. Next.
Victoria.
Oh, and hold on one second. Level 8 and above.
Yeah, definitely.
So none of this level, none of this 4 or 6 shit. Mm-mm. 8 or above. Next.
Victoria, dog whining in the crate only prior to food time or when he needs to potty. I don't move fast enough. It turns into loud barking. I bonked and bonked. He doesn't care. Next step.
You might be bonking not hard enough. I'd take him out of the kennel and bonk him. Say no first. Always bonk. Remote collar. Or use a remote collar. I would go to a remote collar. It makes life so much easier. Anyway, you need a remote collar anyway for all your off-leash control. Next.
Okay. Craig, hey, Jeff, I have two dogs, brother and sister, 8 and 7 years. The male gets jealous every time we pat the girl. He even cuts her off from coming to us.
Ooh, what would you suggest? Fuck that. Ooh. So what I want you to do is this. Craig, you're going to teach the out command. Out meaning literally get the fuck out of here. So what you're going to do is this. Remote collar on the dog. If you don't have a remote collar, fine. Prong collar on the dog. This is the concept. The offending dog has a leash on it. The offending dog has a leash on it. Okay. And it's going to, you're going to call the dog over that you want to pet, like the non-offending dog. The other dog's going to start coming over to you. If you have a remote collar, you would say out, stim, pretty high stim. Now have the other person with the leash at the beginning make sure they guide the dog in the direction you want it to go, away, away. So don't send the dog to place. Don't tell the dog to down. You don't have to put the dog in the crate. You're literally telling the dog, get the fuck out of here. And what happens is you'll just say, out. Dog moves away. It's magical. Next thing will happen is this. Ready? You call the dog over. Guess what happens? The dog automatically moves away with no command. It's beautiful to see if you do it properly. That's what we're going to do next.
Feisty pet training and boarding. I know you care about people so much, but you must also turn potential clients away. You also suggest that trainers should not care more than the owner.
Never. Yeah. I probably turn away $5,000 a week in business away. The reason is because it's not the right match. It's not the right match. I'm looking for owners to win, but we need to generate revenue. I mean, I talked about that today we did a Facebook Live about this new dog, Max. I talked about that. But yeah, I turn away a ton of business because I don't think it's the right match. And I want owners to win. We're probably not the best trainer for them, or I don't think that they will be successful. And that's not being negative. And that's pro-client. And a lot of people are like, well, what about the dogs? What about the dogs? I'm like, what about the dogs? Like, the dogs live with humans. The humans need to be successful. If the humans are not successful, then the dog won't be successful. We don't turn dogs away, ever. But they're attached to humans. So that's who we talk to. As far as don't care more about the owner, it's not your dog. Unless you want to be a living in your car with 30 dogs and broke and divorced, start caring more about the dogs than the humans. And that's what happens. No. Next.
Nate, hey, Jeff, my 9-year-old lab border collie barks when it hears someone at the door every time.
You missed a bunch of questions.
Why is it always doing this?
GG.
It's because it goes automatically to top chat.
Oh, maybe not. Live. Okay, go ahead. Maybe you didn't. No. Or maybe I'm too far down. Go ahead.
Stop it. Don't question me. Now I lost my spot because you made me scroll. Nate, hi, Jeff, right where I was. My 9-year-old border collie barks when it hears someone at the door every time. Started getting worse with her age. Is she too old at this point?
No.
Is that it?
Is she too old?
No.
Is she too old for what? To train, right?
Yes.
No.
Maybe give a suggestion on what to do.
They didn't ask for a suggestion. The question was, is she too old? Right, I answered.
Nate, you're going to have to ask again. No. Oh, shit.
No. But I already answered how to stop the barking at the door earlier with a bonker with someone else. Next.
Christine. Have a 1-year-old rescue puppy, 40-pound pit bull mix, who's lunging, jumping, growling, barking when sees a person or animal. Can't distract him with treats or anything. What do you suggest?
Okay. I won't yell and scream.
Boy. She's new.
What's her name?
Christine. I've never seen it spelled like that. She's new.
I don't even have her here. I'm way ahead.
Don't worry, Christine.
Okay. This is the thing.
Oh my God.
Redirection will never work. It's impossible. It can't be done. All you're doing is you're reinforcing the unwanted behavior. Do you really think a couple of treats is going to keep your dog from being aroused? What I want you to do is this, and I talk about this all the time. The first sign of arousal, you have to apply a punisher. So no, apply your punisher. Now what's your punisher? Leash pop, remote collar stim, bonker, heel tap. Has to be a punisher. No, apply the punisher. Don't wait till the dog is exploding. It's the first sign that the dog is aroused. What's arousal? Do-to-do, do-to-do, do-to-do. But I don't even want the do-to-do, do-to-do, do-to-do going on. Next.
That's going to look interesting for people who are listening on like iTunes because they didn't see that.
I was shaking my head. Next.
Mike, I'm missing Angelo on the videos, getting back on the payroll.
I know. I trust me. I'm trying to get him to do tips of the day. Next.
Barking Bakers. Hi, guys. I was wondering, what do you consider jobs for house dogs? If a working breed isn't being worked in the traditional way it was bred, could it still be trained as a house pet?
Of course. Most people that own border collies don't have sheep. Cattle dogs don't have cows. Right? Chihuahuas aren't sitting on top of jewelry boxes biting people trying to get in. I mean, most dogs are not doing what they, carting dogs aren't carting.
Is that what Chihuahuas are bred for? Interesting.
So, and most perimeter protection dogs are not protecting perimeters. So work is work. Start with obedience. Next.
Cheryl. I'm from New Jersey. Wish I could have joined you this weekend. Yes, I need Skype for my Dobie. I have my bonker, prong collar, and e-collar working.
Oh, nice. Well, get your ass down. Cheryl, get to New Jersey. There's still audit spots available. Next.
Haley. Hey, Jeff. Seeing so much progress with my dogs on the walk. Nice. Passing other dogs, and they're not barking, pulling, growling.
Yes.
Dogs have even approached us, and I have kept them from reacting. Now seeing dogs scared when loud trucks pass by.
Ah.
He is on prong and can't run, but I can tell he wants to. How do I work?
You didn't do is recognize that a little bit. Give your dog a little bit of space. Tighten up the heel a little bit more. Let the dog know. Don't worry. But you don't say this, but it's like, I got this. Next.
Barking bakers. Do you guys still do Periscope?
No, I haven't done Periscope for years. Next. But you don't need Periscope. We got this. Next.
Ricky. Hi, guys. Just want to say thank you for the show. It helped light the fire under my ass to work towards my training career. Keep up the amazing work.
Ricky, proud of you. Nice job. Next.
Helen. Hi there. I'm at a loss. I have 12 dogs, and one of them gets the rest of them crazy with barking, etc. I use an e-collar for the troublemaker, but I can't always be there to stop him. Help.
Helen, you're the one with 12 dogs. Your world is going to be chaos. I wouldn't be surprised if all of them needed a little bit of help. Always go for the biggest offender, so you got that idea right. Get yourself a bark collar. And that dog, get yourself a bark collar for that dog, which goes off automatically. Next.
Mm-hmm. Kelsey, my coonhound mix has trouble with overreacting when on the leash. I've done bonker, e-collar, and prong collar pops. He will scream whenever I correct him. I don't know how to correct his behavior.
So you get yourself a dramatic dog. Oh my gosh. we've had coonhounds that have like the smallest little correction. They go, it's like, oh,
you're going to cross the earth.
Oh, this is terrible. It's the end of the world. It's like, oh my gosh.
I still have PTSD about it.
Drama for your mama. It's like enough already, you coonhound. All right. So, it's possible. What you want to do is you need to start addressing it at the beginning of the sequence. I'm going to say that a lot now. I mean, I say that all the time. You might be waiting too late. Try to do it at the beginning of the sequence. Also, try a dominant dog collar. Next.
Svenja. Oh, she came back after last week and scare her away.
But what happened?
Hi, guys. I don't know. I just remember her. I remember she was new and usually new people.
Oh, when I attacked her?
And you.
Oh, fuck.
I have my own dog boarding business. I'm wondering if
congratulations.
I should correct unwanted behavior of my client's dog the same way I do with my own dog. For example, using a bonker or prong collar.
Yes, but make sure your clients are fully aware of what you do. Full transparency. Mm-hmm. Full transparency. Like all this stuff that I tell you that we do at our training center, our owners know we do it. They all do. Why? Because they're going to have to do it possibly. Next.
Allison, hey, Jeff, do you put the prong collar above or below the shock collar? I feel like I'm not getting much reaction to the prong. Could it be too loose?
It could be too loose. Historically, the prong collar goes above for directional control. Next.
Michelle, I have a five-month-old Great Pyrenees. I've tried to train him to use a bell to go out to potty, and he is kind of scared of it. Any tips for me? Also, still bit when we play with him. What will stop that?
Two separate things. I don't do bells. I refuse to allow a dog to tell me to take it to the bathroom. Now that doesn't mean if my dog's all of a sudden, like I can tell they're to the bathroom, I'm going to take them outside. But like, you're not ringing a bell for me. Like you're not ringing a bell for me. It's like, I know your schedule. I know your bodily functions. It's not time to go outside yet. Learn how to hold your bladder and your bowels. Okay. Do some fucking Kegels. Stop putting stuff up your ass so your fucking sphincter doesn't fall out and you'll be fine, dog. Now, that's the downfall. So I don't train that. As far as bit you, no, apply a punisher. But also, what are you doing? If you're wrestling with your dog, if you're getting your dog all ramped up, that's no permission for the dog to put a bite on, but it's going to happen nip, but it's going to happen more. So if that happens, no, you got to apply a punisher to that. And the dog can learn to not put its mouth on you. Next.
Kelly, if my GSD 12 months responds to no when doing unwanted behavior, do I still give a punisher or do I give a remarked word good when he self-corrects?
Okay, so that's a really good question. Theoretically, don't water down no. Always, always apply a punisher to it. But if the dog, but I've absolutely probably said no to my dogs. In fact, I know I have, and I didn't have any way to follow through with it. They stop the bad behavior. So next.
Grace, your bluntness is amazing. I have a service dog in public access. He never hears that very often.
What? How dare you say that?
I have a service dog in public access is impossible without punishment. Tasks are impossible without rewards. Thanks for your honesty and openness. Would you look at that?
You're welcome. Yeah, the whole service dog, the service dog community needs to they need to wake up. They need to wake up, especially the folks that are self-training with nothing against self-training, but it's like, if you really have a service dog, if you truly have a service dog, that dog better know what a punisher is, because it needs to perform. It is performing a job to an incredibly high level of success, or else you have to wash the dog out. So, and the way you get that is through proper application of a punisher, aversive control. It's the way it is. Of course you use rewards to train the stuff. Well, now it's time to put into the real world. Next.
Go figure. I can put her in a downstay for a solid 4 hours. I don't know about unsupervised though, but still when she's out of the command, she can be annoying, like bump into knees or become nosy.
So she's probably isn't good with spatial issues. Remember I talked about out. So if she bumps in your knee or gets nosy, like, you know, nose bagging you, you can use that out command without move away from you. So out literally is a great command to tell your dog to like, just get out of my space, to get out of my space. Next.
Cassandra, what advice do you give to owners with reactive dogs who are hypervigilant and nervous, looking for other dogs all the time? Human, that anxiety fuels the dog's reactivity, but it's so hard to control.
Yeah, the same thing I would use. We apply the punisher. And again, if you're brand new to the show, I talk about punishment a lot because it's the only way to stop it unwanted behavior. If you're brand new, I can tell there's a bunch of new people listening this week. We're food trainers. We train with food and clickers. So we use a marker system. We use food as a reward to train all of our obedience. All of our obedience, we train that. And we do hundreds, if not thousands, of repetitions. And then we go to wrong, because they're not ready for the punisher yet. And then when we know they've done enough repetitions and they're under voice control, we go to no and apply a punisher. That's the sequence for us for training unwanted behaviors. I mean, for training obedience at a certain level. Now, when it comes to stopping unwanted behaviors, you go right to punishment.
Her question's about the owner, though. The owner is hypervigilant and nervous.
Oh,
her anxiety is fueling the dog.
So what you're always going to have that. So our job is human training. So we teach that to teach the owner how to, first of all, okay. How do you get a dog? How do you get an owner like that to be successful? You have to have success. You have to have success. So what you do is this: you grab the dog, you're with the owner, and you role play over and over and over again. You start in a busy area. So low environmental area. You work on leash handling. So leash handling, body position, breathing. Okay. Posture. Got it? Timing of everything. Slow the owner down. Everybody wants to go fast. Walk slow. Do some directional changes. Do some automatic sits. Get the owner to be fluid. Remember, they don't study dog training like you study dog training. They haven't trained as many dogs as you. Then what I want you to do is start introducing small environmentals. And I want you to be right next to your owner. And I want you to talk to them without shaming them, blaming them, or condemning them, or making them feel bad. Okay? It's a team. You're in this as a team. You're not the boss. You're their leader. Okay? And then what I want you to, and I want you to talk them through it. This is what we're going to do. You can relax that hand. We're going to focus on what's ahead. Stop overthinking things. Stop doing analysis paralysis. Your dog is doing fine. Let's go. And you're going to walk them through. The first sign of any arousal, you shut it down. You can run the remote if you want to. All right? You have to start your dog. The dog owner, dog owners have had failure for so long because they're being failed by our dog training community out there, that I don't blame them for being a wreck on the walk. We need to show them that we can be successful, and then we duplicate that, and then that's how we get owners to do it. Because you can't say, hey, stop being a wreck. It doesn't work that way. Next.
Andrea. So I'm sitting in such a weird position because I'm in like a lot of pain. Andrea, hey guys, having a hard time with place command. My dog follows me everywhere, can only be alone in another room for 10 minutes, then comes looking for me, currently saving for an e-collar.
So a little cheat on that is, first of all, can your dog stay in place while you're there? So make sure the dog, since we live in the city, as you can hear fire, and my windows are open.
Emergency.
You hear a lot of fire trucks and fire and police cars in my neighborhood. So place while you're in the room for at least an hour. Great. When it breaks it, is it gone to punishment level, meaning no leash pop, and then the dog goes back to place? If it hasn't, you shouldn't be leaving the room yet. It needs to know what no means before you leave the room. Then you leave the room, set up a video camera, dog breaks place. As soon as you notice it, you say no, apply the punisher. You'll do that. Cheat on that is put the dog into a tie back. Dog can break place, but it can't get off place. And then when it breaks place, you'll see it. You say no, apply the punisher. Remote collar is great for that. And then the dog goes back. That's sort of it, the quick version. Next.
Sean. Hey, Jeff and Joelle, thank you for taking the time to do all the live feeds and Q&As. You guys are the best.
No problem at all.
Happy to do it.
And guys, tune in this week because we're on the road. So we do a lot of Instagram stories of our travels. The daily...
Mostly Jeff is making fun of me the whole time.
The daily events that happen in our travels is on Instagram stories. Next.
Tracy, our foster puppy is great outside the kennel, but throws a fit barking like crazy and scratching at the floor of the kennel for 20 minutes before he'll settle down for the night. Suggestions, please.
Yeah, make it suck. Even a puppy, and I don't know what you're calling a puppy, but even a 12-week-old puppy, make it suck. Walk up to the crate. No, hit the crate. Hit the top. Hit the side. Got it? It'll make the dog hate the crate. No, it won't. I've never seen it. Nope, we've done it thousands of times. Next.
Feisty pet training and boarding. Bonker causing brain damage. What are people doing? Putting a pipe wrench inside the towel? LOL. How ridiculous. Yeah,
no. People are so desperate. People are so desperate that they're making up all these lies now. And now it's coming from the balance community too. It's not even like coming from the positive community. People are really, really fighting against this. The towel. Like the towel from hell. The towel that ate Cleveland. Next.
It's like the next super like villain in a movie. Right. Gigi, hey, I'm a newer follower and had so much fun learning a new perspective on dog training. You help so many people and it's a beautiful thing to see.
Gigi, welcome to the family.
Welcome.
Big New Year's Eve party. Next.
Caitlin, can you elaborate on how Kira went through a windshield? That's crazy.
Sure. So Kira, she does protection work. She has been trained to deploy out of vehicles and deploy into vehicles and deploy on top of vehicles. And when she's in the RV, there is a time where she is allowed to protect the RV. When I am in the RV driving, not then. Like, mind your own damn business. Don't worry. I got a gun. Like most RVers do, by the way. If you're ever thinking about breaking into an RV with a person in there. So what happens is, this. If I'm sleeping, she can make some noise. She's allowed to make noise if I'm sleeping. She's alerted me because I sleep in rest stops, truck stops, Walmart parking lots, sometimes in the middle of nowhere, like in Arizona or Texas, some rest stop where there's nobody except for me and a bunch of coyotes. So she's allowed to alert. If I'm not in the vehicle, she can bark all she wants. Not randomly. She's barking at something. But I want people to know it's like, yep, there's dogs in here. Don't come in. So what happened was I was in South Carolina. I just pulled into a seminar location. I parked the vehicle. I got out. I walked into the seminar location because I want to go see where I'm going to put my stuff. I came back out. My front windshield is cracked. Like, cracked. And I'm like a baseball, a golf ball, like a rock, like it couldn't have been a chucket ball hitting the windshield from like somebody playing fetch. I was parked next to the dock diving pool. And I'm like, what? And what happened was there's probably dogs. There's a lot of dogs there. People walking by, right? Somebody with a dog or some person might have walked right in front for all I know. Because when I'm not in the vehicle, I contain her a lot of the times. So what did she do? She most likely tried to deploy out the front windshield. That's what happened. Because it went, girl doesn't do that. And I didn't have text at the time. And this is something Kira would also do. So that means her head smashed the windshield. That's my Kira story.
Jennifer, hey, Jeff and Joelle. So glad I found you guys 10 days ago. You've already taught me so much on my human reactive foster dog. You are the bomb. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Jennifer, you're welcome. You're welcome. You're welcome. Welcome to the family, Jennifer.
Cheryl, sometimes my dog hesitates going from command to command. Even a cue with the prong collar or e-collar, he delays in taking the command. Is he being stubborn? Do I reward once he responds?
So this is the thing. How many repetitions with rewards have you done for every single command? I would break it down. Break it down. So your dog's just having transition problems. So I would break it down. I would do work on one command. Let's do this. Let's make on Monday, do one command, make it awesome. Tuesday, the next command, make it awesome. And this is a dog that knows commands, guys. Like you're not going to train a dog in a day how to do all these commands really well. And then on Wednesday, do the same thing. And then start pairing from one to two, one to two, one to two, one to two. And then, yes, you speed up with a remote collar. All right. Also, if you have not hit subscribe and then hit your notifications next.
Madison, y'all are amazing. Working with the e-collar has been going great. Wondering, will my rescue dog, who has every issue in the book, need the e-collar on walks even after the training period?
Madison, yeah. But guess what? You don't have to do it. Try it without. The goal is not to get the dog off of equipment. Training is forever. Reinforcement is forever. Why would you want to get rid of a tool that you can have a conversation with your dog up to a mile away in high levels of distraction out of sight? Right? There's not another training tool out there that can do that. There's just not. There isn't. How do you shut up a dog that's barking 400 yards away in a field? Your dog. Can't. How do you quiet your dog down when you're in your bedroom and your dog's in the basement? You can't. Remote collars are great. Fall in love with it. Don't let a lot of trainers will be like, well, then the dog's not trained if it still needs the collar. Fine. Your life is awesome. And then you just suck as a trainer. But you can take your dog everywhere. Our goal is not to get our clients' dogs or even our own dogs off of equipment. It's not. Our goal is to make your life easier. That's all I care about. Is your life easier? Then that's a win. Next.
Blake, I love your show. It has helped me finish my training for now. Will you be putting out more videos that show you working with dogs?
Oh, there's probably thousands of videos with me working with dogs. The thing is, I'm not training dogs at the training center anymore. I'm running the company and I'm traveling doing my seminars and I work dogs there. So I'm not, I'll start doing some more Facebook Lives again, but I've got an awesome staff. Like they're working the dogs. They're working the dogs. Next.
Jenna, what is Joelle's skincare routine? Her skin is flawless. Oh, so nice. DM me on Instagram. It's kind of complicated. And it's just like the oil and the lighting right now. It's nothing special. I'm pretty simple.
Cool.
Yeah.
Next.
Carlin, what more can I do for storm anxiety? Dog double down on place, no hiding, kept accountable with e-collar for holding command. She's terrified even when it's drizzling outside. We took a walk in the rain to desensitize.
Did it work? I mean, this is the thing. You could always, the problem is it's hard to predict storms sometimes. So, you know, we've done, if you can talk to an essential, I'm not against essential oils at all. And I'm not against CBD at all. What we do in creating a positive association with a storm can be hard. So there are people that say, do fun training and activities during storms. You could try. We don't do that. We don't do that. So, but you can give it a try. So I can't give you my opinion on that because we don't do it. So I don't know. So give it a try. What we do is we have dogs hold command when they're anxious and correct them when they are physically moving around. Mentally, we can't control right now. Even though remote collars at low level actually can get a dog to start soothing. Believe it or not. Believe it or not, it can. So that's what we do. Next.
let's see. H. Wood. This is a 2-3-parter.
What? Ready?
Extra large, aggressive Anatolian I took on from the E-list through the pound. Keeping apart from my other dog for now. He's listening to me for the most part, but has tried for dominance a couple times with growling. Just ordered a muzzle. Going to try to train him in that. Getting e-collar. Any special tips for such a large dog?
I have no idea. So I owned a Turkish Kangal who recently died. And he tried to bite me every day. And he got into dog fights a lot. I've worked with power dogs. And I don't know what your skill set is. So I'm glad you're getting a muzzle because it might get messy. All I know is this, with a lot of these dogs, at some point, it's animal against animal. Right? It's animal against animal. Who's going to win? Now, we don't train sit. We don't train down. We don't train place. We don't train heel. We don't train recall. We don't train tricks. We don't train tasks. We don't train anything like that. It's not what I'm talking about. But unless you've had a dog, a power breed dog, that does not want to, like, run with that program. So a lot of people said, oh, I've owned Rottweilers all my life and I didn't have to do that. Okay. But what if you did? So you need to find the people that have shared the same struggle and tried things and that didn't work. Then what did they do? You know what I mean? You got to find folks who have failed over and over and then figured out what works. And there are some dogs out there who it's like, okay, let's go. Let's get this figured out right now because this has got to stop. No more of this nonsense. No more of this you challenging me stuff. You need to take me a little bit more seriously. And you can't reward the dog out of that. Build a better relationship. The dog's idea of the relationship is it telling you how things are going to be. And I humanize that a little bit. But they're called pushy, snotty, dominant dogs. I mean, you got yourself a perimeter protection dog. You got yourself an independent thinker who is designed to run shit. So, next.
Jake, been working hard with the e-collar since Wisconsin. Was getting really good recalls on 30-foot long line in the park today with people, kids, cars, wow, and other dogs nearby. Hardest part was getting her to leave my side, LOL.
Yeah, put the dog into a down and call it from you then. Yeah. Once you get a dog good on recall, a lot of times what happens is they don't do send outs very well. So just instead, just like put your dog into a down and just start calling your dog. But good for you, Jake. Glad you're working so hard.
Ryan, Joelle, you go, girl. Keep drinking the Starbucks. I'm a shareholder. Leave that Dunkin' swill alone.
Hey, I'm right there with you. Like the only place we stop on the road.
Starbucks.
But no, we've also been to, well, we don't see too many Pete's on the road. Mm. When we were out west, when we were in Seattle, we didn't go to Starbucks. We tried some independent ones.
Mm-hmm. We went to Pete's.
We'll be in Frederick next week just for the day to see Julie and Josh's baby.
That breakfast place is open.
If they're still under construction, I'll be pissed. Have you ever been there?
Their cappuccinos, the foam's this
thick.
That's
right. You have been there, yeah.
Oh, so
yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Nicole, we signed up for your seminar in Indiana today. We are espresso snobs too, although I love Starbucks too.
You can come out to the RV and we got an espresso and cappuccino in the RV next.
Mm-hmm. Make it just right for you. Angelo, my dog has fear aggression. We're in training. When my dog barks, growls due to fear, we are told to correct his behavior with his nylon slip collar and then he tries to bite us. What can I do?
Okay. If you're training with a nylon slip collar, you're going to struggle for a very long period of time. Not too many owners can do that. Not too many trainers can do that. And yes, I've seen plenty of trainers out there that are using nylon slips, walking dogs. I get it. I've seen the videos. I've seen the photos. I understand that it's happening. But what I would do is like, that's probably the most difficult way to train a dog. The most difficult way. Well, actually, probably no leash is probably more difficult than that. So I would say, why would you want to do that? Let's make our life a little bit easier. Let's at a minimum get a prong collar and a 6-foot leash. At a minimum, at a prong collar, 6-foot leash. Next.
Sarah, how should I start working with a dog I don't own? Start with a walk. What would you try and do for a first session?
Depends on the behavior of the dog. Sometimes the walk is the hardest thing. You can work on in and out of the crate. You can work on thresholds. You can work on place. Just work on following you around. All depends on the dog's behaviors. Next.
Sean, I have a Malinois and I understand structure is important for them and you have talked about it. Can you elaborate on what structure means?
Well, if you got a Malinois, you need to know, right? So that's why you're asking. Structure is structure. People keep asking about structure. But why don't people understand what structure means?
Because I guess it's...
This isn't against you. I'm just wondering.
Relative, I guess. Everyone's structure is a little bit
different. Right, of course. But we structure our days. We structure our lives. Yeah. So structure is like just... It doesn't have to be the same thing every day, but you want to just have a dog that understands things. So structure. But the structure of my day with my dogs is like we wake up, they go out to the bathroom, they come back, then we do some. Now we go swimming. Then they'll eat breakfast, or they eat breakfast at night now. Or dinner,
breakfast at night.
They eat one meal a day now. I feed them raw at night.
You only do one.
Yeah. Do you feed twice?
When I'm home, I do. When I travel, one.
Oh, I just do one. I just do 2 pounds a day. Mm-hmm. Yeah, per dog. Yeah. So structure is just. It's, I don't want to say it's the exact same thing every day, but it's like these organized, structured things. So I don't want to say predictable because we want to mix things up with our dog, but that's a little bit basis of structure. Just think about your day. Like, what do you do every day? Like, what's your calendar look like? Next.
Jumbled. Andrew, 10-month-old kind of Corso owner was a pure positive fool. Is there more to that? I think that's it.
Next.
Angelo says my dog that has fear aggression is a 2-3 dachshund mix. Oh, those dachshunds.
Okay. That's still the same. Still the same. If anything, using it, that's one with a slip lead.
Yeah.
A slip lead on a dachshund with all those spine problems. Yeah. I wouldn't do that. Next.
Mike, what model Nespresso? There are tons of different pods. I don't want to send the wrong ones.
It's not the big Nespresso pods. It's the smaller Nespresso pods. So Nespresso makes 2-size pods, I believe. They might make more, but it's the most popular ones, I guess. They make a bigger pod. It's not those.
Yeah, not those. Thanks, Mike. That's really nice of you.
Mike, we'll take a Joelle will take a picture and put it in her Instagram feed tomorrow. Next.
Crixis, hi Jeff and Joelle. Haven't used the bonker in a while. My dog uses it as a pillow now. Go figure.
Go figure. I guess they're supposed to be afraid. I guess you fucked up that relationship, huh? Next.
Florida, my puppy sits very well, but doesn't come to me. Please help, please.
You have to teach it well. Big deal. Sit doesn't mean recall. So you got a long way to go. So what I want you to do is get yourself a long line. Start training recall. We started with food. Food and long line. Next. And just watch a video on how to train recall on my YouTube channel. Next.
Next. Tony, just brought home my beagle puppy, 8 weeks old. Any tips on potty training?
I'm not the potty training guy. What I would do is I would just start looking at YouTube videos or books on potty training. Crate train, the dog should be in a crate, limited amount of real estate in the house, meaning like one room, everything structured. Go to the same potty spot outside, but start looking online. I'm not the best one for potty training. Next.
Slides and spoons. Thank you so much for making these videos. They've gotten me really into dog training and helped my dog and me so much.
Awesome. Next.
Dino, this is Rick from a Skype weeks ago.
Oh, hey.
Working with a ton with my dog and son, 1 year old, just existing around each other.
Nice.
Has been super great with what you advise. What are the next steps, if any?
Next steps is, well, I don't know. I'm going to refresh my memory what we've been doing. I'm doing like 3 to 4 Skypes a day. The next steps of existence is just more existence and get your 1 year old. He's walking around. Get him to start toddling around. Get him to start playing with toys in front of your dog. Things like that. Next.
Marina, ditto with the coonhound being a drama queen. My red bone coonhound will howl bloody murder. So annoying.
I know.
Next. Feisty pet training and boarding. Follow up question. I don't feel the desire to save all the dogs. I have a hard time turning away a snowflake client when I know I could help them get the result they need, but not without a bonker. Want to help all the people? Hard for me to say no.
So you don't feel the desire to save all the dogs, but then you go on, Feisty, to tell me how you want to save all the fucking dogs. This is what you do. It's not about if we can help the dog or not. It's does the owner want the help? So what you do this, Feisty, is you do what I do. You put out massive amounts of free content with no obligation of any financial gain whatsoever. Everybody in every career should be doing this. And then you say, watch all these videos. Got it? And then it's on them. It's on them. If they want your help, but they don't want you to do it the way you do it, it's called a non-client. If somebody comes to me and says, can you train that out, train that, but without this, this, or this? The answer is no. I want you to stop this behavior. Like, it doesn't work that way. That's not anti-client. This concept, the client's always right. It's like, no, it's not. If the client was always right, they'd train their own damn dog. They're coming to us because they don't know. Now, if you have full disclosure on your website on what you're doing. Now, here's a great example. Today, we talked to an owner with a dog, and we talked to them about the dog's diet, and we said, we'd like to put your dog on raw. I have to ask permission for. Why? We didn't talk about that prior to the boarding train. That's new information. But as far as like how we're training the dog and stopping the unwanted behaviors, no, that's on us. We have the liberty to do what we need to get the job done. Next.
Dino donated
$1.99. Oh, thanks, Dino. Questions
coming up. You guys rock.
Thanks, Dino.
Bo Big House. Hi, Jeff and Joelle. Small changes can make a big difference. Shorten the leash and walks with 6-month-old Rottweiler went from all over the place to a very, very nice heel.
Bingo. Good job. Next.
Joseph, planning on your August Providence seminar, watching your behavior mod list. My fastball is off leash, human aggressive.
Awesome. So, Joseph, just to let you know, all my seminars pretty much are doing this now. All the working spots sell out really quick. You have plenty of time. You've got until June to be safe. Every once in a while, working spots on a seminar will sell out 3 months before the date. Providence always does well, though. Providence is like one of our better seminars.
When is that? September?
Yeah, and I get to sleep at home every night. It's August. Next.
Yeah, me too. I know. So nice. Zach, how do you tell the difference between a dog being excited to play with another dog from a dog that wants to go after another dog?
There's some cues. There's some body cues, but a lot of it's just intuition with me. It's just intuition. Did you document that dog today? The dog we had a muzzle up, that 110-pound dog?
I put a short thing on stories.
Did you take any videos though?
Yeah, but I don't know what's usable or not.
Okay. I mean, there was a dog that came in that like, after I gave it a good correction with a bonker, I dropped the leash and let it walk around with a bunch of dogs. And this was a dog that was really sketchy. So, I mean, a lot of it's what's your skill set? How well can you read dogs? How well can you read their energy? How well can you read their intention? And then do you know how to stop stuff? So it's a skill set. I wouldn't want to be able to be like, look for this one thing. If the tail is wagging, they're safe. It's like, I know a lot of dogs, they'll kill a dog, right? Their tail will wag right before they go in for the kill. So next.
Sandy says, I love you.
Sandy, I love you as well.
Kyle, first time commenter. I have 2 GSDs. The 4-year-old doesn't mind baths, but the 7-month screams bloody murder when we try to bathe him. Any advice to help him freak out?
Pain in the fucking GSDs. Ass. So Kyle, bathing dogs is obviously, if you met my dogs, you would know bathing dogs is not my expertise. Stink. Or my personal choice. So what I would do is this. Hose them down outside. Now, there are a lot of videos out there from groomers and from other people that probably have great counter conditioning protocols on how to get a dog in a bath. That's not my thing. We don't. Like if a dog doesn't like a bath with us, guess what we do? Put a muzzle on the dog. Say there's a dog that just definitely needs a bath. It like rolled in something and needs a bath. What do? Put a muzzle on him, put him in the tub, and we rinse them, wash them, and rinse them, whether they like it or not. Next. And if they want to scream bloody murder, we deal with it. Next.
This name again. It's 3 a.m. Haha. I'll teach her out first thing tomorrow. Good night, both of you.
He's from Israel.
Yeah, I don't know how to say it, though.
Okay. It's...
Do you know how to read it?
Yeah. It's really small. Yep. I was bar mitzvahed.
All right. What is it, then?
I don't know.
All right, then.
Next.
Brooke, inside, outside dog, but he always pisses in the house. What would be a good punishment to make this stop?
Okay. I need more content. Historically, what I tell people is, I tell people, grab yourself a bonker, hold it up like this, and hit yourself in the head. That's usually what I say for all these housebreaking mistakes. So you have yourself an inside, outside dog. So your dog's not housebroken because it has free roam to go outside when it wants to, most likely, right? Through a doggy door or an open door. So it doesn't know how to control its bladder. Excuse me, inside. But if you missed it, if you missed it, you're too late. You're too late. So what you do is leash on the dog. You go out to a potty spot. Dog pisses outside. You actually use a clicker to reward it, and you give it food. That's how you start conditioning these dogs to piss outside. As far as the correction for it, you got to be careful. So there's the thought process, because we don't do this, because we don't have dogs that do that. So we don't do this. So I don't have enough expertise on that behavior to give you good advice. So is it the thought process that if you correct your dog, if you catch it in the act, it'll just look for places to piss that you're not watching? So I'm not the best guy to ask that question. Next. $5 top chat. Cindy M, $5. No question. Thank you so much, Cindy M. Maybe your question's below. Next.
Andrew, 10-month kind of corso, ex pure positive fool, following your videos, having great success using prong and 180 move and pre-walk bonk, still nudges an inch ahead, pop harder on 180 or use
e-cow. I would switch to the e-cow. An inch ahead's not the worst thing. Try a heel tap though. Next.
Joseph, I have a e-collar technology 300, but not there yet.
All right. You'll get there.
Helen, it's me again with 12 dogs. Troublemaker is in bark collar. However, once he barks, the 11 others bark too. Oh. The collar lights him up from other dogs barking. He screams and shuts down.
Oh. Pitiful. Okay. So, Helen, I'd have to come up with something really creative on this one. So, what I would do is this. I would keep the dog on a leash. Set the dog up to bark, say no, apply a bonker. Because then he won't scream with the bark collar. Or put your settings lower on the bark collar so it doesn't trigger on the other dogs. Or get yourself a better quality bark collar that's not triggered. But with 12 dogs barking, who knows? Next.
Our friend from, did you say Israel? Yeah. Says, seems like you need 11 more bark collars.
Right, exactly.
Jamie, my dog is aggressive and has attacked me before. How can I correct my dog's behavior?
Okay, so Jamie, that is a Skype session. That's a Skype session. Okay? That's not something, your safety is in question. That's not something I'm going to casually just answer. It's a very long process. What I would do right now is this. Get your dog to have a muzzle. Get yourself to have a muzzle. Start out with first of all, take away all affection right now. All affection. None. Your dog's attacking you. It's biting you. It doesn't deserve it. It's not deserving of affection. Okay. Unless it was getting into a dog fight and you like were breaking it up and you got bit. Another story. But if your dog is actually redirecting on you and biting you, that's not acceptable. So that's an imbalanced relationship. So, but I'm not going to tell you like to do something and jeopardize your safety right now because there's a lot of variables to do. But that's my specialty, just to let you know. So for starters, what I will say is get the dog muzzle conditioned. That dog should be sleeping in a crate. That dog should be in a crate when you're not home. That dog should have no off of all furniture. That dog should learn how to go in and out of a crate on command. Threshold work, all your basic obedience stuff. And then you have to learn how to whenever it's aggressive, you have to make sure right now if it's aggressive towards dogs, keep it away from dogs. Aggressive towards people, keep away from people. None of those things are going to fix these problems. I'm just looking for you to start the process and keep yourself and everybody else safe. But that's not something you just be like, how do I fix it? It's major. It's major, major, major work. Next.
Kelly, so if we say no, you have to give a punisher, even if the dog stops the unwanted behavior.
Theoretically, yes. During the training phase, yes. Next.
Sandy, Golden is still jumping up after prong collar maneuver.
Okay. You didn't do it hard enough. You didn't apply a punisher then. Because it wasn't a punisher if the dog didn't stop doing it. So you didn't make it suck enough. You didn't make it suck. Dogs just don't jump at our training center. dogs at our training center just don't jump at us. We make it suck. Why is that? Why do dogs not do it? And then it's also because of the relationship we have with these dogs, which is like, they won't jump on us. So you didn't make it suck enough. Next.
Slides and spoons. I have a small dog. Should I get a prong to reinforce her heel?
Yeah. They make up to, you can put a prong collar on a 8-pound dog if you want to. Next.
Sandy, can you do place in multiple rooms?
Multiple rooms, multiple place beds. Yes. You can do place outside, inside. You can do place in your vehicle. You can do place anywhere you want. Next.
Big leap of faith dog training. Sometimes I'm a stupid trainer.
Yeah. Two females. Welcome to the club.
I have two females in heat and my male German Shepherd is going crazy. It occurred to me that I should have the e-collar on, pairing it with place command. What a game changer. And I can finally relax without him whining excessively.
There you go. Next.
Karen G, a seat lover. I'm trying to train my dog to walk off leash with e-collar. I basically should use working level stim instead of leash pressure. Thanks.
Yep. Keep the leash. So it's do leash pressure, remote pressure at the same time. The dog gets the dog gets into the positioning you want. You release the remote, you release the leash. Also do right step over. So practice this. You're walking. All of a sudden, take a big step to the right, apply the remote pressure. Dog's got to get next to you. Also start walking backwards. Get the dog to walk backwards with you. Yep. It's like you follow my leg wherever I go. Next.
Bernardino, what e-collar do you recommend? Or if other online viewers know the answer.
Sure. E-collar technology or Dogtra. Next.
Deanna, thank you so much for all your free content. I'm more confident and so is my dog. It's been a game changer. Bummed I can't make it to your seminar in New Jersey. Hoping you can come back.
But you're close enough to the Providence seminar. So come to Providence. New Jersey is technically local. So it's going to take us 3 hours to get to that seminar. So you can come up to us. And all right, next.
Pedro. Hi, Jeff. Me and my girlfriend love your show. My dog seems to prefer running with me wearing her regular collar more than wearing her harness, but am I misbelieving it and just pulling, forcing her to run? I think that's it.
No, I mean, you do what is good for you. I mean, if, let's see, the dog, which one does the dog like?
The regular collar more than a harness.
Okay. So there you go. Are you forcing the dog to run? Your average dog will put the brakes on if it doesn't want to move. So next.
Oh, so sorry, guys. I can't stop yawning. Grace, reinforcement is forever. Perfectly trained service dog uses e-collar every single day for off-leash tasks, intending to use it for the next 10 years of work.
Yeah. Good. Kudos to you, Grace. I mean, a lot of people think like all these dogs are supposed to be bomb-proof. And it's like, you know, are there dogs out there? Let's say there is. And I'm sure there is. Absolutely there is. I've seen them work. They're amazing. But how about if a dog is bomb-proof with a remote collar? What's the difference? What is the difference? And this is the thing. Do people really think that if you put a remote collar on a dog, it's just going to start doing stuff? Like, do people really think that? Like, all of a sudden, do people really think that using a remote collar is like the lazy person's way of training? They do. It's like, you realize that you still have to train the dog, right? Like, you still have to do hundreds and thousands of repetitions. You still have to understand reward and punishment. You still have to have good timing. You still have to understand your markers. You still have to, there's a lot of stuff you still have to know. Like, it's not like, put this collar on your dog and all of a sudden push a button and it'll just start doing stuff. No. That's why Mac was barking.
That cat?
There's two cats. Yeah. Yeah, there's two cats out there. So, next.
Mimi, important tips or rules training e-collar with two dogs?
Do one at a time. Do one at a time first and then both of them. Next.
Tracy, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Svenja, I've been binge watching your videos. You can't scare me away. I am hooked.
Svenja, thank you so much. Next.
Grace, hate hearing people claim dogs aren't trained just because of tools. Ridiculous.
It's very ridiculous. It's funny because, you know, so many dogs are like not trained. It's like easy for you to pass judgment. So, and this is it. People that say that are just not nice people. That's it. Simple as that. Next.
Sandra, analysis paralysis, LOL. This is me and the e-collar that's still in its box on the table. Please don't yell at me, or maybe I need that.
What the fuck, Sandra? Sandra, you are on my show all the time. I bet you, you've probably made 500 fucking comments. You're on my YouTube channel. You're on this podcast. I see you on Facebook all the time. You see all these dogs doing stuff. And your remote collar is still
in the box.
In the box? What are you waiting for? I know what the problem is, Sandra. You're worried you're going to make a mistake. I hope you make mistakes. You're supposed to make mistakes. Welcome to life. Are you going to fuck your dog up with this damn thing? You won't. Why? Because you're afraid you will. That's why you won't. People are not messing their dogs up with remote collars. They're just not. Because they're afraid they will. That means they won't do it. How many dogs come to us messed up? They never had a remote collar on. Well, there goes that theory that remote collars are messing up dogs. The lack of a remote collar messed up that dog. Times 10 million dogs out there that are messed up at a minimum. Next.
Christina, my dog has a tendency to headbutt with her muzzle if certain people get too close to her face or hover over her. Can you tell me what that means?
It means that I was going to do some like the stars are aligned with Jupiter thing, but I have no idea what I'm talking about I have no idea when it comes to that. It's like, what does that mean? It means like this. Did you see the fucking sun this morning?
No.
Holy shit.
No, I didn't. I was like, couldn't leave.
It was. Guys, was the sun – so in Providence, I'm driving back from the gym, and there's, like, fast-moving, like, mist.
What are you talking about?
And I'm looking down Smith Street, and that's where the sun rises, you know, down Smith Street. And, you know, everybody – in every town in the United States, the sun rises down Smith Street, just to let everybody know. And all of a sudden, the sun is humongous.
Wow!
It's a humongous ball of fire. Sitting right there, and I'm like, is that a reflection off of like a gas station sign that's like that? I'm like, holy shit, because it was low and it was bright, and it was like, I'm like,
we haven't seen the sun in a while in New England.
And I'm like
it's been raining for a while. Like,
holy shit, that's the fucking sun. And then you have this mist going in front of it, and it was just like, so you're seeing like this, you're seeing the middle of it, and all of a sudden you're seeing the bottom half of it, and then every once in a while you see, I was amazed. It was beautiful.
So what happens when there's like 24 days of rain in a month?
So
the sun is pretty incredible.
What is the, so why does your dog do it? Because your dog doesn't like space. And in order to get rid of pressure, people moving forward, it's releasing the pressure. So how do dogs do that? They bark at people, they bite people, they walk away, or they headbutt them. And there's probably a couple other ways too. So your dog is just saying, hey, get out of my space. Right? So who's asked that? Christina? So Christina, if I walked up to you like really close, if I was a close talker, what would you do? You might headbutt me, but you probably would push me away. $5 top chat. Sandra Buck. Yep, that's what I needed. Thank you.
$5 to get yelled at.
Who else does that?
A lot of people.
David Smith.
Yep.
You know, he only does $4.99.
Mm.
Yes.
Got him beat.
Next.
Leslie, 6-year-old female, interferes with affection to 2-year-old, both females. Older is twat to 2-year-old, if I correct her.
So teach. I mentioned this earlier in the show. If you didn't hear it, go back to the show. You're teaching the dog the out command, which means get out of here. So what you're doing is you'll say that dog out, and it literally means back away from me. Next.
OBC canine training. My DSD is so obedient and learns so fast, but my lab mix seems to be so stubborn. She seems to backslide so easily on obedience. What do I do about the stubbornness?
So OBC, since you're a dog trainer, cool, right? You're going to learn some skills, learn some patience, learn that all dogs are not the same. You're going to have a lot more empathy for your owners who are struggling. These are all awesome stuff when you struggle with your own dogs, right, OBC? So what are you going to do is, well, you got to find a motivator. What's the motivator? Reward. But if the dog already knows stuff, we take away the reward. correction. So now the dog is motivated by it, doesn't want to get corrected. Next.
Kathleen, GSD Freya has been on e-collar for a month for leash work, walking at heel and distractions, and it's been a game changer. This is my first time watching live. Great advice that is based on reality.
Kathleen, congratulations for doing all the hard work. By the way, all of you that are doing all the hard work, kudos to you. Hey, feel free, give me a thumbs up if you like the show. And guess what? If you don't like the show, give me a thumbs down if you think I'm a real asshole, because it doesn't matter to me. And YouTube goes, oh, people are interacting. And then hit the subscribe button and you'll see more of the shows, and hit your notification. Next.
Joseph says, perimeter protection, yes. Dominant, yes. Loves me like I'm God, yes. Not snotty, no. I think that's the, what dog?
But the one that bit him, though.
Yeah, what?
Wait, is that the one? Joe, I thought it was a female, though.
No, this is the one dog.
The Anatolian Shepherd?
Anatolian, right? It's aggressive. Dog aggressive, though, I think.
Dog aggressive? Okay.
Pretty sure.
Next.
Scattered Storm. Hey, Jeff, late to the stream. Great day of training. Both dog and I learned lots from working together and observing behavior.
Awesome.
Looking forward to tomorrow and what we learn from each other.
Awesome. Cool. Look at you.
Amalgam. I work at a doggy daycare that runs very unruly packs. When I first started, we were averaging one bad fight a week.
Jeez.
Right now, we can go by months without a bad fight, but I'm getting in trouble for being too tough on the dogs. I just don't let things get out of control. Sometimes things just need to be stopped no matter what. Am I wrong? Am I too tough? I'm not kicking a dog or anything, but sometimes I do hard corrections like slaps on butts and pushes.
So
we aren't given e-collars to squirt bottles and slip leads.
Okay, so this is the thing. Hey, guys, do you know why we're not having fights anymore? Like, there's a reason why we're not having fights. It's like, not because you let all these friendly dogs in, and even friendly dogs will fight with enough arousal. There's a reason why we're not having one fight a week, which is a great way for the owner to lose his business or her business. The reason why we're not having dog fights anymore is because of what I'm doing. So if you don't feel like you're being, if you don't feel like the job is serving you properly, leave. Next.
Danielle, I have two dogs in an unfenced backyard. Just bought two e-collars. How should I use the e-collar to keep my dogs from running after people walking their dogs in the backyard and not being territorial?
Long line on the dog and make it suck for that action. Next.
Scattered Storm, saw a photo of a dog who had been stabbed with a prong, was surprised to see the pic. I'm guessing it had to have serious impact, like owner buckled it into the car and attached a prong.
Possibly. I'm not going to discount. Yeah, I won't discount that it doesn't happen. There's some shit prong collars out there. I won't discount that. The prong collar could have been bent improperly, like someone bent it improperly, because the way it's designed, it doesn't do that. It gives even pressure. And It could be a lot of different things. And also don't believe everything you read in the paper. Next.
Scattered Storm. I couldn't possibly actually injure my dog like that with a prong if I tried.
Correct.
Aldo, protocol for moving to another house, especially for male dog who marks.
Oh, limited real estate, massive structure. Next.
Don, just bought a dog to a 1900 for my 2-year-old pit rescue. She has some people and dog reactivity. Should I just jump in with the e-collar or do more leash work? Great YouTube channel.
Do more leash work and start the remote collar on place command and get the dog to start following you with the remote collar. Maybe do some remote collar heel and then boom, jump in. Next.
Kristen, when are you in Chicago? Melissa posted the link to the seminars.
Yeah, go to jeffgellmanseminars.com. Next.
Mike, how do you get dogs to get up on small items like those balls or small chairs where they can barely fit? Can you do a video getting a dog to sit on one of the balls?
Food lure. Leash pressure and food lure. Next.
H. Wood. I hear you, Jeff. He only got along with me at the shelter, so I took him on before he was executed. I've taken him everywhere to socialize. Executed. Jeez. And he listened.
So H. Wood, you fucking put the wrong word there.
But I have a feeling he's going to try and take over home and soon. So muzzle might have to be on for a lengthy period of time. I'll look around for people with Kengel experience and take it by feel. My skill set is limited, but I'm learning.
Okay. All right. H. Wood. I know where your head's at. And you know the reason why I know your head's at? Because you use the word executed. That's why I know your head is somewhere. And you're not a bad person, H. Wood. You're not a bad person at all. Let's clarify that. But when you put the word executed, and yes, you're right, the dog was going to be put down. It's like the dog was going to be slaughtered, right? But that's an interesting choice of words, executed. It's possible that you're using too much emotion with this dog. It's possible. And I only say that after working with 10,000 owners, okay? So it's possible that you're doing that, all right? So what I want you to do is be careful how you're letting your emotions possibly control your decisions in what you're doing with this dog, as well as increasing your affection levels and freedom with this dog when then you should be doing the opposite. Just, I could have nailed it there. I might be off, but I think I might have nailed something there. Just think about it. Don't react. Don't respond. Think about it. Next.
I can't sleep, so I'll ask another question and laugh my ass off. How would you proof a fetch command? Sometimes she just loses interest in the ball and I have to go get it. Is it possible to apply remote control?
So I don't teach fetch, so I don't know. You want to look for somebody that teaches forced fetch. My dogs just fetch because they're ball crazy. Next.
Oh, it's pronounced kohav, which means star.
Oh, kohav. Yes.
I will have to remember that.
Kohav.
So I can stop skipping your name.
Yes.
Melissa. Oh, she posted a link to the seminar. Kelly, should I attend Providence seminar if dog is leash reactive but has basic obedience?
Yeah, well, fucking get that leash reactivity taken care of that weekend. Boom. Done. All set. It's like the dog comes in leash reactive. Wah! Comes in the training center. Leaves the training center. Okay. Yes. Next.
Cindy, you explain about crate training for separation anxiety. Any ideas of what to do when an RV with no room for a crate?
You're fucked. Cindy, you're fucked. So if I had a dog with separation anxiety in the RV, I would get a crate. So in your RV, underneath your dinette, crate. Put your couch down. Put the crate on top of one part of the couch. Try to underneath the bed. You might have to raise up your bed a little bit. Put the but you have your water tank there, most likely, possibly your water. You got your clean water there, but you might have to do that. All right, next.
Feisty pet training and boarding. Thanks, Jeff. I guess I just feel frustrated. I had several people struggling, even getting bit, but unwilling to follow balance training because it sounded too mean. I wish I could help these people, but I guess it'll...
Feisty! Stop.
Staying in my lane and keep producing video content.
Okay. These are wrong people. No shit, they're going to get bit. That's what's going to happen. You can't complain to me if you don't follow those simple rules. You're not allowed to complain to me anymore on that. I have massive empathy. Mm-hmm. Sympathy, maybe not. Empathy, yes.
Mm-hmm. I know. That's why I chose my words wisely.
Yes. So this is the thing. I'm telling you what to do. Next.
Gregory, I have a GSD, 17-month-old, when seeing another dog barks and wants to play. Prong on dog does not correct, nope, even with pop release, but can turn and walk away. Any thoughts?
So Gregory, right. So whether the dog wants to play or not, I don't want the dog to be, if I was walking my dogs and I saw your German Shepherd getting all excited, I might be like, I don't care if your dog wants to play. It's making me nervous. Not me personally, but I can see why the general public would be nervous. So when your dog is aroused like that, a leash pop, if anything, could possibly ramp it up. Switch to a remote collar, make your life easier, and then work on eliminating the arousal at the very beginning of the sequence. Next.
Danny, you saw a video of a woman demonstrating proper use of e-collar with two Mastiff and 30-pound something playing in front of a pit. She was hitting the pit with shocks constantly when it moved. Was this right?
I don't know. And I also don't comment on other people's videos, but I would need, that's your perception of it. I would need to see it. And even if I saw it, I wouldn't comment it because I will never, ever, ever in my whole career comment on anybody else's video. I will never make a comment on another dog trainer publicly. And in private, I don't even comment it in private. My mind doesn't work that way. Doesn't work that way at all. I've never posted a comment on anybody else's page other than great job. You're doing fantastic. Awesome looking pack. My mind doesn't work that way. So, but I have no idea from a description. That's your interpretation of it. I'd have to see it. And even then I would need a big picture. And even then I wouldn't comment on it. Next.
Kelly, what do you consider beginning training with punishers? I think my dog understands no, and I'm confused with why I should still give a punisher if the dog responds to no.
Kelly, you don't have to. Then don't do it. Then don't do it. If your dog responds to no, now, but this is the thing. If are you saying no every day to the same thing, then you need to apply a punisher. So if you're always, here's a great example, Kelly. First of all, you don't have to do anything I suggest. Nobody has to do anything I suggest. People can take, you can literally say, holy shit, I'm going to do everything opposite of what Jeff says. It won't bother me at all, by the way. I don't take any of this stuff personally. You can say, I'm going to, you know what? I'm not comfortable with that. I think I'm going to do this, this, and this. But let me give you a good example, Kelly. The dog, your dog gets up onto your counter, okay, to counter surf. You say no. The dog gets off, right? Dog listened to you, correct? Tomorrow, the dog gets up onto your counter. You say no. The dog gets off. Dog listened to you, right? This will go on for 365 days. Or the dog gets up on your counter and you make it suck with a high-level correction because it could die if it gets something off the counter or at least have surgery, and then the dog doesn't get up on the counter anymore. Kelly, it's your journey. You decide. If you're happy with your dog is and if you're happy with how things are, then don't. Then don't. If you want to make things a little bit better, I just need a little bit more information on what you're trying to stop and how frequently the dog breaks the command, and I can help you. Guys, it's an hour and 30 minutes. It's the end of the show. And we didn't get through. Not that bad. Weren't that bad. Sorry, guys. So, I hate to have questions left over, but you got to go. Yeah. I know you do. Yeah. I'm surprised you actually made it this long. Mm-hmm. Don't fall asleep driving back. I'm madly in love with you guys. Today is Wednesday. Tomorrow we leave for New Jersey. We're documenting our whole trip. So make sure you jump into Instagram on that. Instagram stories, you can see it live and unedited. And then everything else goes up. It takes a little bit of time to go up. Photos and video go up. This weekend, I'm going to be in New Jersey doing a seminar. The following weekend, I'm in Elkhart, Indiana. There's still audit spots available for the seminars. You go to jeffgellmanseminars.com. We're driving in the RV. Big road trip. We're going to go for all the folks out there that are fans of Julie and Josh from Julie's Canine Academy. We'll be staying with them on Monday. And hopefully the baby's home. Is that out of the NICU yet?
I think they're going home. Yeah. Yep. I think they already did.
Did they go home? So you'll see the baby.
I'm going to hold it first. Him first.
That's fine. I'm going to be teaching Josh how to properly train to change a diaper. Oh, he's a little bit confused on how to actually prep the balls. He doesn't know to wipe the creases. He doesn't know how to do the creases. He doesn't know.
There's a lot of them at that age. A lot of creases.
You got to clean the creases.
I know you do.
So he doesn't know how to do it. I got to show him how to do it.
I'm sure he's fine by now.
And I'm sure he'll probably have to put a gas mask on. He's the dad that has to that's repulsed by, you know.
Yeah, and then after a week, he's going to be like, I don't even care.
I hope so.
Elbows deep in it.
I hope so. Yeah. I hope so. All right. Madly in love with all of you. It's been fun. It's been a pleasure. Thanks for all of you for sticking around. There was a lot of new people on the show tonight. I can tell. Welcome. And for all the people that are like every week, every show you're here, man, well, I love all of you. But the ones that are really dedicated, geez, Louise, you guys are killing it. I'm really proud of you. And for all of you on the big watching, if all of you are watching this show and you want to take a photo of it, or a photo or a video of it, if you put it up on your Instagram page and you tag us in your stories, I repost it. So a lot of people do that. A lot of people will do that. All right. Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. This is Joel. And we'll talk to you later. Bye.